The views shared on this podcast are those of Mike Sowers and do not represent those of Commercial Investors Group. The information shared is not investment advice. Please consult your financial, legal, and tax advisors before making an investment decision.
There are two kinds of people in the world. Those that worry sharing their ideas will hinder their success, and those who are driven by the success of others. The first kind view everyone as a competitor. They guard their playbook tight to their chest, rarely collaborate outside their inner circle, and are reluctant to show their cards. Then there are the second kind, the kind who have graduated from the first category. They don't count the number of deals they've done. What counts to them is the number of people they impact and the depth to which they impact them. Achievement is still important to them, but it's subordinated to the depth of their purpose. So they give freely of their time, knowledge, and expertise to build a bridge for those who follow in their footsteps. These are the people who were called to change the world. These are the people who develop people, places, and ideas. And this is the show where they do it, on the Creative Commercial Real Estate Podcast.
Welcome to another episode of the Creative Commercial Real Estate Podcast. I'm Mike Sowers, your host. Joining me is co-host James Smith, and we have a special guest today, Matthew Wagner of Siebert Construction. And Matthew is an expert general contractor here in the Twin Cities, and we're going to talk about some really cool stuff today. We're going to help you understand what are the different ways you can hire a general contractor. We're going to talk about some of the pitfalls of those ways to contract and things to look out and creative ideas for how you can structure that agreement to incentivize the contractor to think like an owner. And then we're going to get into what is the overall process of contracting. We're going to talk about what are the four different phases that an investor goes through in their contract timeline and how they should spend money and take on risk as they move through those. So for the fixed segment of value-add properties, this is a really important episode today, and welcome to the show.
For those of you who are serious about taking your investing game to the next level, you can purchase our book available this May of 2021 on Amazon. It's called Commercial Real Estate Investing, a step-by-step guide to finding and funding your first deal. Or you can check out the website commercialinvestingmastery.com to learn more about our coaching program and our partnership program, where we partner with students in all the major markets across the country to do deals together.
All right. Well, Mike Sowers here, joined by co-host James Smith for another episode of the Creative Commercial Real Estate Podcast. And we have a guest, Matthew Wagner, on the show today. Matt, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me. Morning.
Matt's with Siebert Construction, and they are a reputable firm in town here that does construction management and general contracting. We've asked Matt to come on the show and just really help us dive into the fixed step. Of all the different steps, the fixed step is one that is probably the hardest step when it comes to really understanding how to create a scope and specifications and come with a good budget. So without further ado, we're going to jump right into it. So Matt, give us a quick flyover of the different ways that you can contract with a general contractor and a discussion on what's the difference between a general contractor and a construction man.
Sure. The typical one that we see in public work is the design, bid, build. That's where it's a hard cost, where it's publicly bid. So the general contractor submits a number based on a set of documents and specifications, and any unforeseens are handled with change order. A lot of times there's no assist by a GC on this. The architect and owner will work in a vacuum. A lot of times maybe get some inside, outside consultants, but really work through by drawing it out, scoping it, and planning it, and then the contractor puts a number. And it's kind of a triangle, a trinity, where the owner's on the top, then we got a general contractor and an architect. And then they have different contracts, but work in collaboration to deliver the project. Another one is a GMP type delivery with a general contractor or a construction manager, where they're brought on early. Yourself might have a plot of land and you might have know, you know, what the building you have in front of you, how you want to approach it. So you'll bring on an architect and a general contractor early on, sometimes pay some pre-construction fees, but they'll work together, collaborate, and get your program put in place in the most effective, efficient, and cost-proficient way so you can hit your mark and move forward with that project. Sometimes that can lead to the contractor assisting and then also them putting it out to bid against their competition, or they can proceed under the agreement that, hey, we helped you assist with this. Here's our GMP, guaranteed maximum price, that the contractor will work with and deliver your project. Also, there's the CM role alone, where an owner will hire a construction manager, already working with an architect, define the scope. The construction manager will only advise. Well, there's two ways that can be handled. It can be handled as a construction manager at risk, where the construction manager still holds the contracts, or it can be handled as a construction manager as an agent, where the owner actually holds the contracts. Construction manager just manages scope, schedule, and budget over the course of the project and receives a fee. Those are the common ways that we see it handled in our industry. But there is an additional one that we like to see as well, is design build. That's where the owner works with a contractor to develop a scope. Then the contractor brings on a design partner to help deliver the project, and they hold the contract of the design. The first three ways I talked about were the kind of the holy trinity, where it's owner, contractor, and owner, designer. This one, it's just a contract between the owner and the contractor, and the contractor works through a design build delivery model. We really prefer that one, especially as you kind of hit on the front when there isn't a total scope, because we can operate and come up with creative ideas on how to keep costs down. Look at different constructability models, look at different ways that logistically we can complete the work. But then we have that insight before anything's put on paper. And when we can put that insight down, there's no rework. There's no design dollars being lost because they went one direction and then have to take two steps back and go another direction.
Yeah, that makes sense. So you guys prefer the design build over the kind of standard, you know, design bid build type construction, because then you guys control the design aspect of it and are able to select your architect?
We'll make the recommendation, but yeah, I guess maybe control is kind of a forceful word. We own the collaboration because we can do real-time pricing and we can set up milestones to hit these dates and say, okay, we've got the, let's say, the shell of the building done. Let's take it. We've got the information we need from the designers. Let's price it really quick. And is precast really the most effective way to go? Or should we do a steel building or something of that nature? Because the market is speaking differently, depending on labor pool, depending on material cost, all that good stuff. There is a sense of control as well.
And so when you say own the contracts, you mean the direct contracts with the subcontractors. So in some of those scenarios, owner contracts with the GC contracts with the subs, as opposed to a true construction manager without risk. They're really just being hired as a project manager. They don't take the risk, and the owner's contracting directly with the subs.
Correct. And you're more in that advisory role. I mean, you do have some say, because you're an agent on the owner's benefit, but yeah, really contractually, nobody has to jump for me.
That makes sense. So that's a good discussion. So let's jump into now, just give our listeners a high-level flyover of the construction process from general conditions through to kind of site work, demo, if any, on down to the finishes. You know, can you run us through kind of maybe some of the, how does a typical new construction project go from start to finish through the divisions?
Let's say we're got a brand new site. We're just going to build let's keep it simple, a box warehouse. What we would do from a general contracting standpoint, get to understand, one, what your program is, what type of building, and what's the function of it. The more most clarity you can give us on that, the more easy we're going to be able to capture the total price and not have any unforeseen things we didn't think of. So we're going to build a warehouse. You want to be the most cost-effective model that there is. We would quickly, you know, do an analysis, and let's say it's 50,000 square feet all day long. That would be a precast building. If we're doing a warehouse function, maybe with a little bit of office. And so we would get our partners involved and saying, hey, one, what 50,000 square feet, what's that price point going to be? And two, what's your schedule look like? Because, you know, you just can't turn precast around tomorrow. Yeah, that's sometimes 12 to 14 to 16 to 20 weeks out. And understanding that shell building, the base building, what we're going to be providing. And then through that conversation, we'll ask, okay, what type of finishes? What things are you going to be storing in the building? Is there an office element? Is there any infrastructure from bathrooms, You know, is there a water requirement in this warehouse? Are you going to be doing any manufacturing, electrical needs, and getting all that through all the spec sections? And we'll start out with earthwork and work through all the finishes. By that, I mean paint, drywall, flooring, doors and hardware, all the way to mechanical, what's going to be needed, electrical, and fire suppression. And talk with all of our trade partners or subcontractors to make sure that we've got the program, we've got the dollars and cents inputted into the estimate. And also, like I said previously, when we talked about precast, we will understand the schedule to make sure that we can meet your need and deliver the building. From there on, going forward, then we would work with you to either recommend a architect or to maybe you've got a architectural partner of your own, and then refine that program into exactly all the details we need to build a building. From, okay, what are your parking needs? What do you want the front door access to be? Is there any kind of branding you want on the side of the building? You know, how many parking spots, sidewalk, the whole functional of the building. And we would then work with the architect to develop a conceptual set of documents, something down on paper. That would be the first step. We would price the conceptual set of documents and work to that and hone in more as the designers are working to design development, which we call DD documents. A lot of times we see those to be 50% complete. And by that, 50% is your project into design development would be 50% designed. As we work through that, there'll be some choices made on, let's say you wanted a different type of finish on your precast panel. You didn't want exposed aggregate. You wanted something a little cheaper. So we went to smooth and painted. We would show you the analysis of, say, here's an exposed aggregate, which already looks finished as it comes out to the site versus what our number is to paint the gray panels that come out to site because they're smooth and protective. Again, hone in those line items through the estimate, then get the design team to get us a set of CDs, construction documents. This whole time, we've been pricing as we've been going on, evolving to make sure we're on budget, and also having conversations about material decisions to make sure that we're on schedule. And once the CDs come out, a lot of times they'll be 80% complete because there's always some kind of timing. Something's not going to be quite done. We'll be able to put numbers to that 80% complete, carrying just a few allowances, and be able to enter into a GMAX, if that, a guaranteed maximum price, or a contract amount that say, hey, your project is going to cost X. Once all of those are complete, we submit everything to the city for permitting, make sure that, because we need a signed contract before we'll do that, and then we can start to go into construction. You know, there's many iterations that I kind of tried to keep at high level, not get into the weeds. There's many iterations. That's really the high level process to get to a project price. Start out with conceptual, go to design development, and then get to CDs so you can sign a contract and we can submit for a permit to proceed with the project.
Nice. So that gives people a high level flyover of the whole process from start to finish. Now, so within a new construction deal, you got kind of your site work, then you're building your shell, then you're waterproofing in the shell, and then you're working on kind of the any rough framing inside, and then you run all your mechanicals and electrical trades, so plumbing, HVAC, electrical rough-ins, all that stuff gets inspected. Then we're insulating the space. Usually there's an insulation inspection. Then you get the framing inspection somewhere in there. Normally all the mechanical rough-ins have to be signed off, right? And then you get your framing inspection, and then you can insulate, and then you get the insulation inspection.
Correct.
And then you're good to drywall everything. And then, so all the finishes would be like drywall, flooring, paint, trim, all the finished carpentry, cabinets, countertops. And then all the mechanicals trades come back in after all that's done, and then they finish everything up and final out their permits, and then you get the building final. So I think a lot of times people don't even understand that process. They don't understand that you have to schedule an electrician twice on your job. You have to schedule a plumber twice on your job. You have to schedule all these people twice. And so managing all that stuff, how do you guys manage production schedules across all of your jobs? Are you guys using the software, some kind of spreadsheets, or what's your process?
Typically, we work with our superintendent, project manager, work together to develop the schedule. And it's just managed in Microsoft Project. We're pretty simple. That's an Excel-based Microsoft product. It's really simple. once we get into construction, we have weekly coordination meetings to talk through, make sure we are tracking on that schedule and what constraints have we come up that are stopping us from hitting those dates that we put together. But really the superintendent owns that through the construction portion. You know, I help solve because we're a team. That's how we use it, Mike.
Sure.
It's really collaborative, though. We're not the type that's going to be the, you know, dictation. We collaborate with our teams.
Does Microsoft Project have, like, can you set dependencies between different schedule items to show, like, critical path, like in a Gantt chart?
You can do predecessors and set up predecessors so you can understand finish, start, finish, who's coming next. You can overlap. So, you know, your painter isn't going to come in after all the drywall is complete, for an example. You know, their drywall is going to work from, let's say, west to east, and painter is going to fall behind him, and we can see the dependencies on that. And the drywaller lost the day, is the painter going to catch up with it type of scenario.
So when you do that, do you create multiple schedule items like for drywall, like drywall west corridor, drywall central corridor, drywall east corridor, and then you're creating multiple painting schedule items? Or like, do you just have the schedules overlap overall and you just have one drywall line item?
Typically, we have one drywall line item. I mean, if it's a really complex project, like a phased project where we need to work in one area because we're confined to that area and then move to the next, then you would have multiple. But for typically what we do from our projects, we typically have one. You can manage it per team however you want, but to answer your question, no.
I just know, like, if you're a listener and you're planning on managing your own project, and most of our stuff we're doing is value add, and I think most of our listeners are doing value add as well. So we're talking existing buildings they're going to buy and they're going to clean them up. And so the real question is, how do you evaluate what renovation items to do and which renovation items not to do? And the answer to that question really lies in the cost benefit analysis of each particular scope. And so just kind of a breakdown for the listeners on how you go about looking at a new building and figure out what your scope should be, because there's a lot of different things that you can do, but maybe you should do some of those items to create value and maybe you shouldn't do some of those items. And I think it's important that our listeners get educated on how to know when to do certain things. And so here's the rule of thumb. There's five different ways to create value in a building through a renovation. So anything that would increase the rent rate or the rate per square foot that somebody's willing to pay for a space potentially is a good item to do. So most of the stuff that we see for cosmetic updates, large surface updates like new siding on the outside, carpet, paint, things like that that have large surface areas that we can update, or like landscaping, those things tend to make people want to pay more for a more updated look. So that's probably the first thing that I think people should look at. And in most cases, those things do pay for themselves. So the idea there is, if you can generate one additional dollar of rent, then that dollar of rent per year actually creates anywhere from $10 to $20 in value in your building, depending on what your market multiple is. Now, what is a market multiple? A market multiple is just the inverse of a market cap rate. So if the market cap rate for your building or that type of building in your area, let's say you're looking at industrial buildings in Hennepin County, Minnesota, and we determine that the market cap rates are 8%. What is 1 divided by 0.08? That's 12.5. So what that's saying is that additional dollar of income that you generate from doing this remodel actually creates $12.5 in value in your building. So that's your break-even point. You can spend up to $12.50 for that dollar of income in order to break even. So if it only costs you $6 to create that extra dollar of rent, which creates $12 in value, then you've doubled your money by doing that item. And that's really where the value add comes in. The idea is that we look at each individual item and say, how's that going to impact either increasing the income or decreasing the expenses? And then what is the value of that net increase or net operating income increase? And then how does that compare to the cost? And the idea is that you're spending, let's say, $200,000 on a remodel, but you're increasing the income such that the multiple of that net operating income increase is like 2 to 3 times that. And that's really the idea. So the big categories that I usually see people having to evaluate are energy upgrades, which do the second way to create value in a building, which is actually decreasing operating expenses. So anything that decreases operating expenses increases value in the building, because it's all about net operating income. So if you increase the gross income or you decrease the expenses, they both impact the net operating income the same way. So cosmetic updates tend to increase income, whereas energy upgrades tend to decrease operating expenses, particularly utilities. So utilities is a huge one. And so a lot of times sub-metering or separating meters or at least billing stuff back through like a ratio utility billing system, or at the very least, if you have net leases, finding out how to actually bill the utilities back through like the CAM and tax recoverables that you're getting from the tenants. So different utility things. So we're talking like insulating to reduce energy costs, all new LED lights, motion sensors, automated building systems, smart thermostats that actually track use and things like that, where it's not just you're setting a weekly schedule, but they're actually getting feedback on real time, like occupancy and things like that. Sometimes those types of systems do pay off, and they pay off quite well. So that's the second category. And then the third category, I would say, are kind of the big ticket. I call them the oh crap items. So they're the items that if you buy a building and the roof caves in on you or starts leaking and you end up having to replace it and you didn't budget for that or adjust your purchase price for that, that's a big ticket item. I see three big ticket items, and I'm going to go through those and then I'll let you jump in and give me your thoughts on these categories. The big ticket items that I typically see are roof, parking lot, and mechanical systems. So usually what we do on those items is we figure 20 years, if there's less than half of that remaining, we start discounting our price. So let me give you an example on that. Let's say a roof's going to last 20 years, and that's just usually what we figure. I mean, obviously sometimes like built up roofs and things like that, if done well, can last well beyond that if they're well maintained, but we'll just figure 20 years, 20 years for rooftop units and 20 years for a decent parking lot, if done well with a wear course and things like that. So if there's 5 years remaining on it and I have those items inspected, I would deduct half of the cost because I start deducting at 10 years. So if the useful life is under 10 years, I just prorate it with the seller. So if there's 5 years remaining, I would take half the cost of the roof off of what I'm willing to pay. If there's 2 years remaining, I'm taking 80% of the cost of the roof off what I'm willing to pay. If there's 9 years remaining, I would take 10% of the cost of the roof off. And I do the same thing for the HVAC equipment on the roof or within the spaces, and I do the same thing for the parking lots. So as a buyer, that's how you can really go through and get a little more granular in the inspection phase to figure out what the remaining useful life is. And you should be budgeting an annual repair budget that goes into your operating budget for maintaining those things. But you should also be putting a line item on to start a reserve for those things. And that becomes a discount right off of the offer price on the front end. And that's kind of like a balance sheet item. You're going to basically discount the price up front, and then you're going to raise the equity up front to start that reserve. So in our case, let's say the roof's going to cost $100,000. There's 5 years left on it. A roof company comes out and inspects it. It's going to be $50,000. I'm going to raise an additional $50,000 in equity capital, and I'm going to deduct $50,000 off of my offer to the seller when I buy the building. So I just wanted to give you kind of a sneak peek into the mindset of like the value add investor and how we go about organizing these things. And we really go through iterations of estimating. So typically we start with like an estimating spreadsheet, the same as you do, Matt. I saw that you guys are kind of estimating using Excel and things like that. So we have our most common line items broken out by big ticket items, cosmetic upgrades that increase rent, and energy upgrades that decrease operating expenses. And then usually within buildings, there's other value add things. Do we want to add an elevator? Do we want to do a conference room? What are the other amenities that are going to create value in the building? And sometimes they may not pay for themselves, but they may lease the spaces faster and allow you to execute your business plan. Like, I would argue putting an elevator in a building like in our Edina building, putting that elevator in there is not going to increase the rent, but it allows us to lease the spaces, whereas we might not have been able to lease them before. Sometimes it's a little bit more of a gray area because it's not an exact science, but you just got to get an idea of like, what are the necessary renovations that I need to do to be able to fill my building at the rates that I'm projecting in my pro forma in order to achieve the value that we want to achieve. And so that's kind of the mindset there. So give me some thoughts from the contractor standpoint as we go through our iterations of like, you know, using an estimating worksheet to estimate the costs ourselves, and then we kind of involve a contractor. What do you think is the best of the different methods for a listener who wants to buy a building? You know, they've kind of come up with a rough estimate. They don't want to waste the contractor's time. The contractor doesn't want to spend a bunch of time on the front end, but they're also not going to be ready to sign like a cost plus contract right out of the gate. How do you work through all that?
I mean, we're kind of at a fault as contractors, and I laugh about it all the time. An architect will do a rendering, one rendering, and get paid. I can do sometimes 8 to 10 estimates and not see a penny from the client, because that's just how our market functions. My advice to somebody, if they were going to get into the business, if they didn't have a strong estimating background, would be to find somebody. You know, there's multiple different avenues you could go down to find a contractor, but to find one that you know is reputable and have them on board and develop a relationship-based kind of conversation on, hey, I'm in this business venture and can you guys help me out? Because to a fault, as contractors, seem to be, we'll help anybody out, no matter how big of a pipe dream they have or a real business deal. That relationship-based conversation.
So I got a question for you. I mean, obviously you guys are bidding jobs over and over and over again. Have you guys developed like a cost estimating spreadsheet to know like, all right, you know, a 500 square foot asphalt job versus a 500,000 square foot asphalt job? Like, what are the prices? What are the piece rates for all the different common line items? Like, you know, what's an electrician charging per switch? What's a plumber charging per toilet? Like, do you guys have like an RS? I know RS Means offers a super granular version of that. Do you guys have something that's a little more high level that you guys are using to estimate some of this stuff on the front end to give like good faith estimates, or are you guys always going to the sub to get pricing?
It's usually a hybrid. I mean, I could throw you out an office building real high level, but if once we get granular, and even if I have a napkin sketch, because the market's always evolving and changing, I would like to have that input to make sure, you know, something didn't just happen, a hurricane hit somewhere, and now drywall's three times what it was last week. Does that make sense?
It does. So here's the dilemma. So you talk about the contractor dilemma. I mean, that's dear to my heart, right? I was a contractor for 15 years, and that's part of the reason, honestly, I got out of the business. You're always chasing your tail on cash flow, and you're always working for free on the front end. But I mean, that really is like any sales game though, right? You're working on the front end to do proposals. I mean, we put in a tremendous amount of effort as investors on the front end without knowing if we're going to get a deal done. And a lot of times we go through, we even get something signed under contract to spend a bunch of money and time doing due diligence. And the clear decision is to walk away and leave our money and our time on the table. And we've done that in the past and left tens of thousands of money on the table. And you know, those are the best deals you never did. Because you're going to lose a lot more if you closed on it. So here's the dilemma. How as an investor, how do you estimate repairs with reasonable accuracy relatively quickly without submitting yourself to the time constraints of bringing in a contractor to look at it and bid the job? For example, you know, every time I go to have a company like yours or whatever bid these jobs, you know, it's like, all right, let's get out there in a few days. Let's look at it. You know, then you're getting your numbers from your subs. You know, then there's the admin of writing it all up. Then we gather that. And then, you know, now we got numbers. Well, a lot of times a week at a minimum, maybe a few weeks has gone by. And by then, you know, the deal is dead. Somebody else already bought it. So we got to be able to go on and walk through a building and basically decide the same day what is a reasonable renovation budget. And so the workaround that I found is developing kind of a, a renovation estimating spreadsheet. And I think that would actually be really cool to go through that spreadsheet with you. Here's what we're estimating things on the front end. And so here's my idea, Matt, is that we become transparent with you about how we're estimating our costs or our budget, if you will, on the front end, in exchange for you kind of keeping your ear to the grindstone as you're bidding jobs and being like, hey guys, we have a price increase in these areas. And if you give us that real-time feedback, then we can kind of be coming up with better budgets on the front end for you guys when we go into these things and really look at more of that strategic partnership going forward. I think part of the challenge is, you know, there's always like people look at these deals as like a zero-sum game. Like if we pay more, then the contractor gets less and vice versa. And it's more of, hey, how do we work together to get the budget exactly where it needs to be on the front end, save as much costs, and everybody walks away with the most amount of money. And, you know, we'll get into contract structure in a second, but you know, that's my idea for the estimating of the stuff. And then you get a property under contract using that budget. And then during due diligence, after we get it under contract, that's when we actually engage you guys to come in, write the final scope, give us feedback on that, collect pricing from the subcontractors. On some of this stuff, it's like, hey, we're going to do carpet and paint and we're going to replace the LED lights. You really don't need a full set of architectural blueprints. No. Whereas if you're like, hey, I'm going to convert this whole building from office to apartments, it's a different animal, right? Because you're just wasting people's time. They're just throwing numbers out for budgetary purposes that don't really mean anything if you don't have a final scope of work. So that's another thing that I think is a challenge is when do you know when you don't need all the drawings and people can just come in and bid it as is versus when is it actually appropriate to involve an architect and start spending that money during due diligence before we even know if we're going to close on the property. So that's another catch 22 is it's like sometimes you got 45, 60 days to close on these deals. Well, right when you close, you want to get started with construction, right? Time is money. So part of the challenge is if you want to start right away, you really got to start this process of the design, the scope, and the bidding early on, like right after you get the property on contract, but you got to spend money to do that oftentimes. Do you guys typically charge a fee to like gather the bids from all the subs and stuff like that or involve an architect on the front end? No.
Well, when we involve an architect on the front end, yes, because you know we're contracting with them and we'll be looking to get a signed agreement from our client. So we're incurring costs doing the design because we're paying for it. So yes, right off the front, I'll give the client a cost for that design and my coordination time. But on a lot of these deals, let's say Mike, on your Edina building, if you were going to do carpet, paint, and just lighting, there's no reason for me to engage in a design partner. And I would give you a number and we would say, okay, does that number meet with your needs, your budget? Yes, it does. It's actually better than what I've seen. So sign me up. Which a lot of our deals, I would say 90% of our deals are like that. We come in, we look at it, we price it up. Does it meet the client's budget? Yes. Then we execute a contract and get the work done as quickly as possible. And kind of back up on the pricing aspect, we can do pretty quick turnaround. You know, I like to call it real-time pricing, but sometimes the more complex it is, the more input we would like to have. I just want to reiterate that we can get you a number, but there's going to be a level of uncertainty about it that we're going to be doing a little CYA, covering our butts on. But once we have the feedback, we hope we've done our job well enough not to be, you know, 50% high, maybe only that 5 to 10% high. And then we hone it in and dial that number in once we know the total scope of the job.
Sure, that makes sense. It's almost like there's four, I guess, hurdles that we jump over as an investor. And we almost need to have, as we move through them, our scope needs to get more detailed. Our budget needs to follow suit with the scope. And our willingness to spend money increases. And so the first stage is estimating stage for the purpose of making an offer. And there, we shouldn't spend any money. And that needs to be like same day, immediate turnaround, like literally plugging numbers into our little renovation estimating spreadsheet and spitting out a number. So that like, it's just part of our process for coming up with the max allowable cash offer. We call it the MACO. We got a book coming out here that's going to teach people how to do this on the back of a napkin, which is really cool. We've kind of crack the code on how to actually analyze these deals, because valuing a property is something that a lot of agents and stuff can do, but figuring out how much to pay for a property and actually make money on it's a completely different animal. And the process is actually relatively easy. We're projecting out the future value, and then we're deducting the cost to fix it up, fill it, close on it, and hold it. And we deduct those four costs to stabilize the building out of there. And then we deduct our desired profit margin. And that's how we back into the make-up.
We typically do that, you know, on a square foot basis. So if the roof looks old, it's got some problems, you know, we'll deduct essentially, you know, $5 a square foot off our eventual offer price, you know, for repaving, you know, $1 to $5, depending upon what the condition of the parking lot is. So we'll just use those numbers. And so the more granular we can get on kind of what those prices are per square foot, that really helps in the front end.
James, you brought up like the carpet example, $1 to $5. So $1 to $5, if you're in that more of that $5 range, is that carrying some contingency dollars in there? Because you're like, you know, let's put it at $5 because we saw that was most of it, but yet we still don't know. How do you guys handle that kind of unknown variable when you're this far out?
I can jump in on that. I think so. In our spreadsheet, I think he was actually talking about asphalt. I think what we would say is like, let's say new asphalt's $5 a square foot. That's where really you could help us. And then remember, we're prorating that based on the remaining useful life. So okay, the number is really, it has two factors. It's the full replacement cost, which starts at maybe 10 years or 50% remaining useful life. And then from there, the second thing is we're applying a percentage for how much we want to actually put into reserves up front. And that's really what we're doing. So if there's 2 years left on the asphalt, like we just bought a building, the asphalt's pretty much shot, right? So if we know we're going to replace it in 2 years and it costs, let's say, $5 a square foot, we want to set aside a reserve amount up front that accounts for that. And that's one of the four costs to stabilize. It's the category that we call holding costs. So in the holding costs, we actually set aside enough reserves for the roof, the HVAC, and the parking lot are our big ticket items that we're not going to replace right away. We're not going to run them through the title company. They're not going to be included on a sworn construction statement because we're not actually replacing them right away. But we do need to include them on our sources and uses. We need to raise enough equity capital up front for them. And that's one of the challenges with these items that you have up front is they're not included in a quote unquote cost that a lender is going to base their loan amount on. We may look at a deal and say like, all right, the roof's going to be $100,000. There's only 2 years left on it. So we need to set aside $80,000 up front so that in 2 years, we have $100,000 to do the roof. And when we do the $80,000, the lender does not include that in a cost. So you're raising 100% of those funds in equity. You're not raising 75% of those funds in debt or whatever your loan to value is that you're going to do. And so raising money for that stuff becomes very expensive. So we must make sure that we include those in our quote unquote holding costs, which ultimately are a deduct from the future value of the property when we back into how much we can pay today. I think if you have a lot of these big ticket items that you have to raise equity for, your overall weighted average cost of capital goes up, which means that, you know, sometimes if you have a deal where let's say we're going to buy it for $1 million and the bank will give us 750, but I got another $1 million that I'm not going to do right away that I might have to do in 2 years. That's a tough deal because you got to raise all that money and equity up front. You don't want to close on it and then have to try and do a capital call or something in a year or two. So like we have an example of that on our New Hope building right now. We raised almost $500,000 in extra capital because we know we're going to have leasing costs and build out costs after that big tenant moves out. So we raised all that money and we're paying a preferred return on that. And it's literally just sitting in a money market account. So we're paying an 8% preferred return, but we're only earning like 0.4% in the money market account. So it really waters down all the other returns, but that's a better alternative typically than trying to go back to the investors and raise more money in a year. You want to know that you have that money sitting there up front. So those are some of the decisions that the investors need to make. Do I raise the money up front and kind of, you're really not losing money on it, but it just, it waters down the returns for the rest of the equity in the deal. So those are some considerations. So we want to make sure we factor all that in the first stage, which is this kind of estimating with the intent to make an offer. The second stage is after we get the property under contract, but before our contingency ends. In that stage, we want to limit our spend on any hard costs. So typically, we would not start spending money on design and things like that, because if we aren't canceling the deal, we're out that money. In some cases, it is appropriate to do that, but normally, what we would do is engage a contractor, start working through the design and things like that. Let's get some more firm numbers on the stuff that's pretty straightforward, like carpet paint, bathroom updates, LEDs, things like that. Let's start getting some ideas. Like, you know, as a contractor, you've done a lot of elevators, right? You got a pretty good idea of what the pit work's going to cost. You don't necessarily need full drawings for all that. And that's kind of phase two before we're done with the contingency period. At that point, we want to get more granular. It's I call it like peeling back layers of the onion, if you will. But we want to be careful about not going all in. And so then the third phase is where we either decide to move forward on our contract or cancel, or sometimes we uncover costs in that second phase that are like, hey, we didn't realize that it was going to cost this much to do the roof or things like that. Maybe we did an inspection and we found out that there was some mold up in the roof cavity we didn't account for before. And so at the end of our second phase, we recalculate the max allowable cash price we can pay. And if that number is significantly different than what we have the property under contract for, we'll either cancel or we'll have a conversation with the seller about, you know, what changed. Maybe they didn't disclose some issues with the building that we were able to uncover and things like that. And I always tell the listeners, there's really two areas, and we call it retrading the deal. There's a right way to do it and a wrong way to do it. Some of these books will teach people to go out and get properties under contract with absolutely zero intent of closing at that price. And they go through the due diligence only to like retrade at the end. And I know there's guys in town that are doing that. They literally just, they go in with the intent to renegotiate the deal right from the get-go. I think that that is a horrible strategy for a variety of reasons. But the main reason being that your reputation is online and the commercial real estate world is small. The other reason being is you're going to run out of time if you wait 30 or 60 days to renegotiate your deal before you start spending money on surveys, phase one environmentals, appraisals, and construction drawings. So, you know, that's the other drawback is, you know, if they say no, then your deal's canceled and you're out. And you could potentially either lose money on the table if you did start due diligence right away when you showed up, or if they say no and you didn't do due diligence, you're probably fine. But what if they say yes and now you don't have enough time to do the rest of the due diligence? So that's the other problem is if they say yes and you're like, okay, now I need to close in 30 days and I don't have enough time. So it exposes you to risk on the other due diligence items like the appraisal, the environmental, and the survey and things like that. So phase three is like, all right, we either renegotiated our deal successfully or we moved forward on the original deal. And phase three is when we can actually start spending money. We know with certainty that we're going to close. The only reason we wouldn't close is if for some reason we can't find debt and equity partners. So in phase three, that's typically when we would start spending money on an architect and things like that. The problem is we don't own the property, so we can't really sign a contract for the construction. So we're kind of informally hiring a contractor at that point, spending money on the construction. And then at phase four is like, hey, at closing, we can sign a construction contract or things like that, and then actually get the work done. Sometimes in phase three, maybe you can sign a construction contract prior to close and have some contingencies that the contract's null and void if you don't close. But if you guys start signing contracts with subcontractors prior to close and for something falls through on our financing or whatever, it's always that balance between getting things done as fast as possible versus taking risks that the deal falls apart and you got to leave a bunch of money and effort on the table. So now that you see the kind of the investor viewpoint, I want to know your thoughts on like, do you have any creative ideas for like, how can we balance those two things well, like getting the job done sooner, more effectively, and getting a better budget quicker without spending a bunch of money and taking the risk that we're going to leave that money on the table if our deal unravels?
it's not a creative idea, but the sooner you can bring us on board, the earlier you can start vetting out what your options are and the thing, the improvements you need to make and not make. Because, I mean, really, all we're out is time. But that's what I see it as an advantage, because the sooner we're brought on board, then you're not down a road already in the wrong direction. And you've already wasted a bunch of your time, the seller's time. And then you realize, oh, crap, that idea is not going to work. So now we got to change gears. It's not creative and it's not earth shattering, but I think the sooner we're brought on and the sooner you understand your complete program, we can help you make those decisions on what you want to add and not add and when you want to do it.
The last thing I wanted to talk about today was conflict of interest and alignment of interest. And one of the challenges, I think, with the two different common approaches, whether it's a firm bid or cost plus basis, is alignment of interest. So I want to talk about that, because when you bid a job and the goal is to make the highest margin possible, right? You're in a for-profit business. That's the idea. So I just know as a GC, sometimes when you bid a job, it's kind of like, hey, now you're willing to get a little more granular on cost saving. Like, you have 100% of the incentive to save costs on the construction side, because every dollar saved is a dollar put in your pocket. On the flip side, but if you don't do well in cost measures, then a dollar lost is a dollar directly out of your pocket. On the flip side, there's kind of the cost plus, where the only way somebody gets paid more is to have higher costs. Obviously, there's the incentive to deliver a low-cost project to get referrals and make your customer happy. But beyond that, the financial metrics of the way the contract's structured do not directly incentivize you to use, you know, subcontractors. And I think we've had this discussion. I just want the listeners to really benefit from this discussion. So the real idea is, how do you make the contractor think like the owner, which is to get a good quality job done on the best timeline with the lowest cost? And how do you actually structure the contract so that when that happens, the contractor makes more, but it ends up costing the owner less? And that's something that I'm not sure that I've completely cracked the code on. And I've done a lot of construction projects. So I don't know if you had any thoughts on that, because, you know, I know there's always the argument of like, well, we can do a cost plus and we want to continue earning your business and that's our incentive. But, you know, I'm not buying it. I would buy if the contract was literally written in a way such that there was an incentive financially for somebody to deliver the project at lower costs. I think that's the holy grail, that if you can crack the code on that, then the world's your oyster.
There's a lien delivery model where the owner holds all the contracts, lien construction holds all the contracts, and then the team, entire team, they set a budget and then they split any money that's saved between the owner and all the trade partners or subcontractors. That'd be probably the purest model. It hasn't ever been done in the Midwest. It's been done out in the East and the West Coast. I think Bolt Construction did it on the billion dollar hospital in San Francisco, but it takes a lot of time. It takes a big room model where everybody's working collaboratively. The only other way I've seen this, Mike, is I delivered a project out in Idaho years ago, and we had a large contingency because there was a lot of unknown variables. We were working on an old lumber site that had phase 1, phase 2, a lot of contaminants, a lot of environmentals. So we had a contingency in there, and any money we saved with the contingency plus any cost-saving measures that we came up with, value, cost-saving items, value engineer with the contractors, we split that. This client got 75%, we got 25%. That really kept us incentivized, that contract, using it as a tool, not as a weapon, as a tool between the team to say, hey guys, if you guys can come up with quicker, more efficient ways of saving. And, you know, we equated that even to days off the schedule, because if we came up with a way logistically to put it into place quicker, we gave back the general conditions because we're saving days on the construction schedule. Those are the couple ways that I know. I can't think of that lean construction process contract model. I can look that up and get it back to you, but that's the two ways I've seen it work really well, because everybody's got some skin in the game.
Yeah, I like those ideas. We're trying to develop a model right now for leasing, construction, and property management that's based on like saying like, all right, if market, let's call market 100%. So the typical market rate, let's say, you know, what do you guys charge normally for like a cost plus? I don't know, 3-5% or something like that? Or what is normally your fee on a $500,000 project size?
Yeah, it's 3-5% with plus general conditions.
Okay. So there's some margin in the general conditions, there's margin in the fee, and then there's margin in any self-performed work for companies that do self-perform. Not all companies do. I can't remember, does Sieber self-perform any of the
trades? We don't self-perform, but like our competition that does, like I'm a Goff, they're the big self-performer. They do concrete and carpentry, for example.
Yeah. Sure. So what we would say is, let me give you the leasing example. So in leasing, let's say we agree that commission's 5% of the cumulative lease amount, or in this case, you guys are getting 5% of the cost. So we set that as the 100% baseline. And then what we'll do is we'll say like, all right, we're going to guarantee you 80% of that number. So there's got to be a little bit of pain if there's not performance. So maybe you get 80% of that number. But then we say like, all right, now the goal is X. And if you deliver the cost at X, maybe that's like, hey, if you don't eat up, or if you eat up 100% of the contingency, then you get 100% of your fee. But if you eat up over the contingency, then you only get 80% of your fee. But then you could say like, hey, if you don't eat up all the contingency, then there's a split on the balance of the contingency. So you end up making like 110 or 120% of your fee. So we're looking at a model like that for like our property managers as well, where we say like, all right, you get 5% of the revenue in most cases. When we buy the building, the revenue is typically super low. So we put a minimum on the contract. So they're actually making usually like 8 or 9% of the revenue out of the beginning because they're hitting that contract minimum for the management fee. As they fill the spaces, it levels off at 5%. But then what we'll say is if the building's 100% full and we collect in full, then we'll actually pay you 6%. And then at the end of the year, there'd be an NOI bonus. So if the goal is an NOI of, let's say, 100 grand, if they deliver a 90,000, they might get half the fee. But then if they deliver an NOI of 110, they might get some kind of split on that. So there's really true incentives on what does the owner really care about? The owner cares about what's their cost basis in the building as it relates to the overall stabilized value. We call that kind of the cost to value ratio. We want to keep the cost to value ratio low, and we want to keep the NOI as high as possible. And that's the name of the game on the investment side. And so I would just encourage you to be, you know, let's continue working through like, you know, some kind of creative model that really incentivizes both parties to do better and really think like owners. I mean, there's obviously the model where, you know, we can actually physically partner with you and also hire you. And I've seen that there's some other companies out in town here that are actually trying to win business by becoming an equity partner in the deals. But I still think that leaves some incentives misaligned in that case still, in my opinion. So, all right. Well, that was a great discussion. I got one personal question for you, Matt, and that is if you had one day left to live, how would you spend it?
What's off the rules that we can talk about?
You'd like to have some fun.
No, to be honest with you, I would spend it. If I had one day left, I'd spend it up in my property in northern Wisconsin with my two kids. There'd be a fishing pole involved. Some time at the beach club with them at the swimming pool, and then probably a couple cocktails, to be honest with you. And I don't mean just my kids. I'm probably any loved ones or people that are special to me, but that's how I'd really like to spend it if I had to kick the bucket tomorrow.
Well, that's good, Matt. It's been a blessing having you on the show. Thanks for all that you do and for sharing your experiences with us here. And for those of you who caught the episode here, we'll have some information below in the description as well. And thanks again for tuning in for this episode of the Creative Commercial Real Estate Podcast.
Thanks for having me. Have a great day, guys.
For those of you who are serious about taking your investing game to the next level, you can purchase our book available this May of 2021 on Amazon. It's called Commercial Real Estate Investing, a step-by-step guide to finding and funding your first deal. Or you can check out the website commercialinvestingmastery.com to learn more about our coaching program and our partnership program, where we partner with students in all the major markets across the country to do deals together.